Okay, thank you. So, for those of you that are finding it very slightly inclement as far as temperature is concerned in here, the temperature has been risen. It should start affecting you in approximately 5 minutes or so. For those of you that still find it uncomfortable at all, engage in a series of positive attitudes and expectancies about the temperature, and I'm sure you'll start to feel the warmth growing throughout you. Just to let you know, and we have received some official confirmation now that Vladimir Dmitry Kokov's flight has safely landed at Heathrow. He's currently negotiating his way through customs, so I'll keep you posted as far as that's concerned. I'm going to be welcoming our next speaker, Mark Tyrrell, just a few moments. Mark has been working as a hypnotherapist since 1993, originally training with British Hypnosis Research. These days, he trains therapists online with his company, Uncommon Knowledge, and sells hypnosis downloads and scripts through hypnosisdownloads.com, where there are over 850 titles listed and more than 500,000 downloads sold, which I hear on fairly good authority is slightly more than Adam Eason download site has managed. He has done nationwide tours training health professionals on how to lift low self-esteem and how to handle bullying in the workplace. His new book on reframing, New Ways of Seeing, will be published next month. Back in 2002 with his business partner, Roger Elliott, who I just want to say, all the guys at their company are really polite. Whenever I've sent them any emails, they're really polite. You know, there's something very valuable for you all to learn there, okay? Take that nugget with you. Their mums told them to take their shoes off at the door, and they continue to do it. They set up together clinical-depression.co.uk to take the new knowledge from human givens about how depression works to the world. Since then, nearly 10 million people have visited the site. He's just completed Maggie's Challenge, a charity endurance event in the Scottish Highlands. So if as he steps up here he's walking a bit funny, you will know why. His lecture is titled How to Lift Depression Fast. Please give a welcoming round of applause for Mark Tyrrell.
Hey, thank you, Adam. And when you condense 20 years of work into a few sentences, it actually sounds pretty good, doesn't it?
Sure does.
Okay. So I have to say I was kicked out of the Cubs at the age of 9. So it's sort of good cub, bad cub. But I'd be working on that for now. I wasn't listening to Adam. I was just, what am I going to say? So I'm going to be talking about depression. And in a way, it's almost disrespectful to the millions of people worldwide who suffer sort of crippling depression to only give it an hour, because obviously, of course, it's a big subject. And it's also, you know, I don't want to lapse into humor too much either. I haven't planned to be spontaneously funny at any point during the lecture. But if I do, it's partly because, who was it that said life is too important to be taken seriously? And there's some truth in that, I think, that we can think flexibly. And what depressed people need is flexibility, creativity, understanding, and of course, empathy. But understanding is paramount. Okay. So what I'm going to be talking about is what depression is, what research has told us about depression, what do we know, what is the current level of understanding about clinical depression. Then I'm going to be talking about the experience of depression. You know, how do people with depression perceive their reality? Okay, what are they doing in their minds and physically that maintain the depressive state? Okay. Then I'm going to be talking about the cycle of depression. And then I'm going to give you a few pointers as to what to do and what not to do, perhaps, when treating depression. Now, even if you're not a therapist, because depression is so rife in the world, you know, one in four men at some point will suffer clinical depression. One in four women and one in eight or nine men will suffer clinical depression at some time. So by the law of averages, either you have been depressed or someone you know may be depressed or a friend of a friend or someone you'll know in the future will be depressed. So the information here today should be valuable for everybody, whether you're a practicing therapist or not. Okay. Just a little bit, 20 years ago, back in the mists of time when I was young, I worked in what was called, non-euphemistically, a locked ward. And the reason it was called a locked ward was because it was locked. And we were locked in with the patients. And the reason we were locked in with the patients was because they were deemed to be a threat to themselves or other people. And so, you know, you have a mishmash of people all together. So you'd have paranoid schizophrenics, you'd have anorexics, you'd have drug addicts, alcoholics, self-harmers, other people harmers, the occasional sort of justice system dodging sociopath getting out of a prison sentence by feigning mental illness, and depressed people. And even in my youthful naivety back then, I kind of felt this wasn't necessarily a therapeutic environment for depressed people. So maybe someone had taken an overdose, and to wake up in the ward, in the locked ward, people like me sort of milling around, and they might share a room with a howling psychotic, and you know there was a curtain partition, so they didn't have their own proper room, and that to me just didn't seem right. You know, you think, okay, so often the depression would worsen, they'd be completely drugged up. And then the revolving door thing would start where they'd come in and out of hospital and so forth. And it was well-meaning care, or well-meaning attempt at care, but it wasn't necessarily the way forward. And so I won't talk about those days too much, about the time I was attacked with a pitchfork by a patient, or the time I had my nose broken, or the time a very esteemed self-important psychiatrist was accidentally injected in the leg with a major tranquilizer by another nurse and had to be put to bed for 12 hours during the shift. But what I will tell you about is something I noticed about some of the patients. And one of the things with depressed patients would often become cataleptic. So you'd have extremely depressed people. These weren't necessarily people who'd been medicated yet either. So it couldn't necessarily be put down to the effects of medication. But they, so you go off your shift and you come back 8 hours later and they'd be in the same position. And then you ask them what they're thinking about and there'd be this disconnect from the reality around them, you know. So it would all be inward, inner focus, inner absorption, depression. Okay, and they'd be, you know, concocting imaginary scenarios about what had gone wrong, what might go wrong in the future, what was going wrong in their life, and so forth. And one thing we know about depressed people is that they misuse their imaginations, not to be confused with them not having real problems. Okay. But they have a real problem, and then they will catastrophize. Okay, so quite often after someone has, for example, committed suicide, and if a journal is found, they may be found to be worrying about money or losing a relationship or a job, when the reality was that the money situation was actually fine, or the relationship was fine, or that their job was secure, and so forth. So they're doing something with reality, imaginatively. Now, when I stopped working in the psychiatric hospitals and started using hypnosis, then I noticed several things, the similarities between these depressed people and deep hypnotic subjects. Firstly, the catalepsy, or the catatonia, which is extreme catalepsy, where someone has a sort of waxy catalepsy, so you could lift an arm and it would stay there. Okay, and you'd see this in psychiatric patients as well, schizophrenics, but also very depressed people as well. Not that we spend a lot of time sort of lifting, you know, patients' arms and things, but you had to amuse ourselves somehow. But so that was interesting. But also, of course, in hypnotic subjects, the inner absorption as well. Okay. And the use of the imagination. So catalepsy, inner absorption, stillness, disinclination to move, and a sense of reality not being real in some way. You know, disconnect from the reality around you. So it seemed to be, these are just sort of initial ideas that I was having at the time, that there was a connection between the hypnotic state and depression. Could depression be a kind of trance state? Okay, this is not an original idea, and I'm sure you've heard it before. And I have to say that the stuff I'm presenting today is not my stuff. Okay, these are other people's ideas, other people's research and so forth. So I am not the originator. So I'm drawing off international research into depression and human givens ideas about the nature of depression and dreaming, as we'll see, and how that relates to sort of treating depression. So, how do you know if you're depressed? Okay, how do you know? So you go to your doctor or your GP, and you're diagnosed with depression. Okay, And you have to be careful, because someone I know recently had a tennis injury, a bad neck, and was offered antidepressants after 2 minutes of consultation with a doctor. So you have to be careful with some doctors. But so how do you know? Well, in the same way that you know whether someone is in love or not. Okay, there's no physical test for depression. You don't go along and have a blood test for depression. Okay, it's not like discovering whether you're diabetic or something. You can sort of be forgiven, because the way we talk about it, you'd be forgiven for sort of feeling that that is what it's like, that that's how it works, but it doesn't. So you know that someone's in love by observing their obnoxious behavior, I mean their behavior, and by asking them about their internal experience, and that's exactly how you determine whether someone's depressed or not. You observe their behavior, which the doctor doesn't really have the luxury of observing your behavior over time, okay, and you ask them about their inner experience. This is how we determine whether someone's depressed or not. So, okay. Yes, let's see. So the criteria for major depressive disorders, depressed mood is quite it's quite important, as weirdly enough, you know. Do you feel depressed? Yes, I do. Okay, well, that's, you might be depressed then. So we got loss of pleasure and interest in usual activities. This is another very important thing. Does somebody not enjoy what they normally enjoy? Have they ceased getting pleasure, satisfaction, from stuff that they used to engage in? Okay, whether it's socializing, sport, or whatever it happens to be. Okay, sleep disturbance, very important, as we'll see. Okay, most depressed people have report some kind of sleep disturbance, whether it's delayed sleep onset, insomnia, not being able to get out of bed in the morning. Mind you, I had that this morning, but you know, these kind of aspects of the experience are very, very important. Talks about psychomotor retardation, you know, basically not moving a lot, or hyper restlessness, and the two tend to sort of, you know, bounce back and forth. Someone can be restless and anxious, and then not be able to move for long periods of time. And then we've got loss of energy, obviously, feelings of worthlessness and guilt. People can start feeling depressed about the depression, start feeling guilty that they have that they are depressed. You know, what have I got to be depressed about? But I am depressed. You know, that kind of thing. Feeling worthless, useless, and so forth. Okay. Difficulty in thinking. We know that depressed people are stressed people. Cortisol levels are always higher in people when they're depressed, which is why relaxation is so important initially when treating depression, to normalize cortisol levels so that they think better again as well. And the prefrontal lobes of the left hemisphere become inhibited during depression. So depressed people are not in their right minds in that sense, in the way that they haven't got access to all of their mind, okay, all of the thinking capacity. So the planning, so the left prefrontal lobes implicated in planning and structured thinking and so forth. So it can be very hard to make decisions when you're depressed. You know, everything's things that normally would seem simple start to feel really complicated and difficult. And that in turn affects self-esteem, of course. Okay. Recurring thoughts of death or suicide, catastrophization, feeling that there's going to be a disaster. Of course, some people start contemplating suicide as well, or attempting suicide. So, what causes depression? You know, why do people become depressed? Okay, why do one in four women at some point become depressed? You know, what are the reasons for that? And so is it bad genes? Okay. Well, there's no gene for depression, no genetic evidence that it's a gene. Okay, is it serotonin? And again, artificially lowering serotonin in non-depressed people doesn't make them depressed. Okay, so could lowered serotonin be a consequence of depression, not a cause of it? As we'll see a bit later on. Personality. There's some evidence that some people are more sort of naturally anxious than others. Some people are more prone to have more natural resilience than others and so forth. But it can't all be explained by personality, because depression has risen so much in the last 50 or 60 years. Okay, so is it just a mass personality change? Okay. Bad stuff happening. Okay. most people who have adverse life circumstances or situations don't become depressed. So it can't purely be explained by bad stuff happening. When bad stuff happens to you, you can become more vulnerable to depression, but it's not a significant cause, okay? Environment, certainly there seems to be changes in the environment which may have precipitated this huge uprising of the incidence of depression over the last 60 years. So it could have something to do with that. And social learning. We know that depression can spread in socially. Okay, Nicholas Christakis, his great TED Talk on the hidden influence of social networks. And he talks about how depression and happiness can spread, you know, and obesity and smoking and divorce and stopping smoking can spread. So a friend of a friend of a friend, someone you doesn't know, what happens to them can have a knock-on effect and influence you as well. Okay. So certainly there does seem to be some evidence that depression can spread socially. So so what do we know? How do we know this? How do we know all this? Well, between 1978 and 1993, the American Public Health Service Agency was formed by the US government to do international meta-analysis of 100,000 pieces of research onto the causes, consequences, costs, and best treatments for and worst treatments for clinical depression. And the findings of that now constitute the international guidelines for the treatment of depression as well. So and there's British Psychological Society and British Psychiatric Society and 73 august societies peer-reviewed it, and 3,500 of those studies now form the guidelines for the treatment of depression. Okay, and a lot of people don't know about the guidelines, amazingly enough. So basically, they found that the rates of depression, which accounts for reporting and public acceptance and willingness to talk about depression, have risen 1,000% in the last 60 years. So genes don't really change that quickly. Brain disease doesn't, bad chemicals and so forth don't really alter that fast in nature. So something's going on there. Okay, so people born since 1945 are 10 times more likely to become depressed than others. Suicide attempts and suicide success, that's the wrong word, have risen by that amount as well. So something's going on. Depression is striking ever younger people, children and teenagers. Suicide rates have increased in that sort of sector as well. So these are the findings. The vast majority of depression is not biologically driven, has biological consequences, but is not biologically driven. Okay, it's not produced, it's not bad. You haven't got a bad brain. Okay. Okay. The average clinical depression will last about 5 months, 5 to 8 months, if left untreated. Okay. More women than men get depressed, as we know. Okay. So the best treatment for depression, as far as the international guidelines go, is a combination of behavioral, interpersonal, and cognitive, which kind of makes sense. So behavioral is what you do, what you are doing. Changing behavior inevitably changes psychology. Okay. Interpersonal, most depressed people have relationship difficulties, and also being depressed in turn causes relationship problems. So as we know, relationships are extremely important to people. And cognitive, the way people think and interpret reality. And because we know that depression isn't an events-driven phenomena, then it's more about what people do with what happens to them than actually just what happens to them. Okay. So getting people to think differently, challenge the depressive trance state is extremely important. Okay. Psychodynamic therapies are contraindicated for depression. The sort of older style analytical therapies, getting people to dig over the pain of the past, looking for, I hate air quotes, I'm actually on an air quote diet, okay, but I've just relapsed. Looking for causes, the cause of the depression, there's one cause, your mother looked at you in a strange way when you were 11, and now you're clinically depressed. That kind of oversimplistic sort of approach, contraindicated as far as national guidelines, but people are still being trained in this way in their droves. Drug treatment shouldn't be the first line of choice or the line of choice, doesn't make sense. Treatment of choice for a depressed person. It should be offered psychotherapy first, but of course, you know, as we know, that's not always an option, is it? And effective psychotherapy is more effective than drug treatment alone. Also in preventing relapse, which you wouldn't expect if it was a biological condition. You know, if people had type 1 diabetes, you wouldn't say, well, you know, therapy, psychotherapy is more effective at preventing relapse than insulin or you know. You know, that again flies in the face that it's a biological disease. Okay. So, that's what the international guidelines have. So it seems that we're living in a depressed world. Okay. Which is quite a depressing thought, actually. But the non-depressing thought in this is that people like you can make a difference. Okay, we can start to, because, you know, information is power, knowledge is power, and knowing about depression, knowing it, how it works, understanding it, and being able to effectively help people, more than just being empathetic, but actually being able to help them, is a hugely important thing. Okay, you know, don't underestimate the effect and the power that you can have in altering the course of people's lives, perhaps saving lives as well. Okay. So depression isn't an inevitable consequence of events. It's not a disease. It can't be classic any more than love is a disease. You might call love a disease, but it's a subjective experience and a behavioral experience. So we can see people behaving in a depressed way and we ask them about their subjective experience. Okay. The reason that many depressed people quite like the idea that it is a brain disease, okay, is that, you know, traditionally there was perhaps stigma attached to being depressed, okay, and in no way am I suggesting that people are to blame for being depressed, because they're certainly not, and sometimes people do have overwhelmingly difficult circumstances. A combination of their environment and their personal psychology is producing the depression, okay, so it's not people's fault. Okay, two responses usually to when you're talking about depression is, you're not talking about real depression though, are you? Okay, that's the one sort of stock phrase that people sort of seem to come out with. And you say, why can't we explore what real depression is then? And the other one is, of, you know, what I've just said, are you saying that it's their fault for being depressed? Okay, perhaps the drug companies have been, you know, implicit in using those two sort of natural responses as part of their marketing as well. Okay, so depression isn't caused. There's no evidence that it's caused by hormones. Okay, as I say, artificially lowering serotonin doesn't produce depression in non-depressed people. Okay. So, what is going on with depressed people? Now, I mentioned earlier that if you're depressed, you always have higher levels of stress hormone in the body than when you're not depressed. And depression used to be called nervous exhaustion. So you get the Victorian people used to go away to the country suffering from nervous exhaustion. And you think, well, what the hell is that? What are you talking about? You know, it sounds, you know, and they recuperate from nervous exhaustion and suddenly we don't talk about that anymore. We do talk about it. We call it depression, okay? So you find when people become depressed, it's invariably, it follows a build-up, perhaps for many years, of increasing stress, okay? Stress levels are increasing. And quite often, I mean, Adam was talking about sort of coupling. I wasn't talking about coupling. He's talking about coupling hypnotherapy with CBT. And in a way, to get access to the thinking brain, then you need to lower arousal levels so the thinking brain can start working again. Okay. So trying to do CBT before knowing how to actually deeply relax someone is I'm sure there's a great analogy that I can't think of. Is like something, but. It really is like something. Okay, it's like trying to drive a car with no petrol. That's what it's like. So the stress is really central to the whole experience. Okay, so state depression is a strong emotion. Okay, now so what does stress do? What's it for? I basically think, well, you know, you become stressed in response to a stressor. Okay. You do a presentation, you realize you've forgotten what you're going to say next, or you're in the jungle and a lion comes towards you, a bill comes in that you can't pay and so forth. So you produce a stress response. Now, the fight or flight response is something we all know about, okay? You run away if you're me, or you stay and fight if you're someone braver, or you freeze, okay, because you're trapped. You freeze. Energy shuts down very, very quickly. Okay. Now, why do we freeze? Because we feel as if fighting or running isn't going to work because we're trapped. Okay. So you see this in nature. If a wildebeest is caught in the jaws of a lion, then fighting isn't going to do a lot of good. Running away is not an option anymore. So it'll play dead response, and energy will shut down very, very quickly. Feel numb. If it could tell you about its psychological experience, it might tell you that things didn't feel real and feel dreamlike and so forth. And, you know, this often happens in depression. So depressed people say, you say it's a strong emotion, but I feel numb, you know, and I feel disconnected from my feelings, and nothing ever matters. Now, we know that is a side effect of some antidepressants as well. But people not on antidepressants also report this sort of numbness of effect, okay? And another feature of depression is learned helplessness, a feeling of trapped. Whatever I do doesn't make any difference, so what's the point? Okay, I'm stuck. So this shutting down of energy occurs. As we'll see, this isn't the only reason for the loss of energy. I want you to think about depression as a severe loss of energy on a physical level, and that equates on the psychological level to loss of hope, as Adam mentioned, and a loss of motivation. Okay. So a depressed brain is a stressed brain, always. As a person comes out of depression, stress levels normalize. The way they perceive reality normalizes as well. Okay. So, we have this. Okay, talked about that. So feelings, we talk about CBT, the premise of cognitive therapy is that you change your thoughts to change your feelings. And it's great that more cognitive therapists are now using hypnotherapeutic approaches, hypnotic interventions, mindfulness and the like, because we know that thoughts don't precede feelings very powerfully. What I mean by that is if you're at home and you're sitting in your room and suddenly there's an explosion next door, okay, you don't think, oh my God, was that a terrorist bomb, and then have a shot of adrenaline and have the fight or flight response. Okay, so it's not your thought that produces the response. You have the response about a second before you have the thought, was that a gas cooker exploding next door? Okay. So in that sense, the whole premise of cognitive therapy is kind of wrong from a neuroscience point of view, but still can be effective. So there are more neuronal connections coming up from the emotional centers of the brain to the thinking brain than the other way around, unfortunately, in our stage of evolution. So that's not to say that thinking differently, you know, really trying to make yourself think differently can't affect the emotions. It's much easier to affect the emotions in order to get someone to think differently, which is why using hypnosis is such an example, and why you can be the creme de la creme of any practitioner out there treating depressed people, because you know how to do that. You know how to affect the feeling level in order to make a difference to the thinking level. But you can do it both ways as well. It's a two-way street, so getting people to think differently can also get them to normalize their emotional response as well to some extent. Okay. So we're going to talk about depressed thinking styles. What do depressed people do in their minds? Okay. And remember at school, physics, you had a prism, didn't you? Remember that? Okay. It's the only bit of physics that I remember. And light comes in, and then it bends, doesn't it? It refracts. Okay. And I'm not going to give you a big physics lecture because I couldn't. But that's what light does. It bends, and people have a bent of mind, don't they? You know, so reality comes in, someone does something with that reality. The calmer you are, the more the reality just kind of does this, kind of stays a bit straighter. But if you're very emotional, the reality will really bend sharply. So if you're really angry, then you'll be slighted by someone who didn't mean any ill intent at all, and the line will really, you know, what you've done with reality is really bent this way, okay? And of course, depressed people are doing that as well when we're depressed. When someone's depressed, they will do that in very predictable ways. Now, Martin Seligman, so-called father of modern psychology, who also instigated the term learned helplessness, found that depressed people everywhere think in similar ways, and that you can predict which children are more likely to become depressed in adulthood by observing the way they think. And the way you do that is by talking to them. And not saying how to think, but you know, just listening to the way they describe the meaning of what happens to them in life. Okay, and what he found was that firstly, strong emotion causes all or nothing thinking. Okay. So we know that perfectionism, chronic perfectionism, is a risk factor for depression. You know, all or nothing, black or white thinking. It's got to be completely this or it's completely that. Okay. So we, you know, if you're enraged, if you have the strong emotion of anger, you don't kind of think, well, you're slightly wrong about that, but you've got a point there. I'm a bit right, but you know, maybe I'm unfair here. You do all that afterwards when you calm down. But at the time, you know, you are completely wrong. You know, you are completely, to use Adam's language, you're a complete dick, and I'm completely right. Okay, this or that. Okay, fight or flight. That's why you have all or nothing thinking with emotionality, because it's attuned to the fight or flight response. It's completely this, because it's completely that. Okay, if you want to make an emotional political speech, you have to use polarity. Okay. You know, completely this, completely that. You can't have subtleties of thought in an emotional speech. Okay, so I find that depressed people tend to describe their experience in all or nothing terms. My life is a disaster. Other people are happy. I'm miserable. Okay, this is completely that. So you see all the bits in between get kind of missed out because the strong emotionality is driving that all or nothing sort of trance state, if you like. Okay. So the wider context are being missed or discounted. Okay, through no fault of the person, we all do this when we become emotional. Okay, or when we enter a trance state, if one exists, you enter a trance state and you forget the room around you. Okay, the room disappears. So something about the context, the wider context, is disappearing for a while. Okay, or the pain disappears from your arm or your leg, and you have an operation. So the wider context is disappearing for that point in time. Okay, so all or nothing thinking is a very important point there. So, more specifically, Seligman found that bad events, and by that I mean something you don't want to have happen, does happen, like your much-loved partner finishes with you, or your prized job, you get sacked, or something like that, you become ill. Or something that you do want to have happen doesn't happen, like you ask someone out and they say no. Okay. For a bad event, in order to respond depressively, you'd need to globalize it, make it pervasive. Okay. So, I failed my maths exam, which I did, by the way, actually. That's true. This is not hypothetical. But I failed my maths exam and, my whole life is lousy. Okay. So, it's not just compartmentalized you can be depressed about something without being depressed, okay? If you think about something, it's depressing, but you're not thinking about it all the time, it's over there, and you've got your other life over here. But, a depressive way of relating to reality would make it pervasive. You spread the badness out to cover everything, okay? I failed my math exam, my whole life is lousy. You internalize the bad thing, your relationship ends, it's all my fault, okay? Or this always happens to me. So it's something about you that's produced the bad thing in some way, okay? I failed my maths exam, I am such an idiot. Not I'm an idiot at maths, but I am an idiot. It's a global thing, okay? And it needs to be to maintain the sort of depressive trance state. And it's permanent, okay? So nothing ever works out for me. I've never been any good. Okay, things will always be this way. So badness is seen as something which is permanent or stable, explanatory or attributional style, as Seligman calls it, something that's going to persist. Now, the worst thing, the big suicide risk for people is lack of hope. Okay, you can be sad, not clinically depressed, you can be sad because, but have the sense that actually this is a temporary state and I will feel better. You're not really depressed. What kicks in the depression is the pervasive or internal, but also stable style that you have in your way of perceiving reality. It's always going to be bad. Okay. And good events you do the opposite with. So they're specific. Yeah, that was good. I got the job. Okay. But everything else is crap. Okay. Well, yeah, they asked them out, and they said they go out with me, but everything else is a disaster. So it's, the goodness is maintained as specific. You don't globalize to the good bit. It's external. I asked her out. She said yes, but she's probably doing it for a bet, with her mates. Or painful memories coming back. Or Or, you know, yeah, I got the job, but they're probably desperate to give anyone the job. You know, they needed to fill the job, so I was the first mug who walked in the door, you know. So it's to do with them. It's not I was the right person for the job. You're not internalizing the good thing, okay? And it's fragile. Yeah, the relationship's great. You know, your relationship's great, isn't it? Yeah, what worries me is it's too good to last. The same person isn't saying, well, this is too bad to last. You know, it was a bad thing. But the good thing is seen as fragile and temporary. Okay. And if you listen to depressed people talk, you will invariably spot these patterns within them. Okay. It's important that depressed people start to understand them for themselves and so they can challenge the state of mind. Okay. So... Okay, whoops. So where do they come from? Well, Seligman found that the primary caregiver, something for parents to feel guilty about, children would pick up their explanatory style of life from the primary caregiver. So if you hear, which is often the mother, but, you know, or has traditionally often been the mother, but, you know, could be the father as well. So the person who spends most time with the child. Early on. So, you know, if you hear your parents saying things like, God, why does this always happen to us? Yeah, okay. Or things never work out. Or, you know, everything's just a bloody nightmare. Okay. Then they're teaching the child by osmosis the depressive explanatory style that we see globally in depressed people. Okay. As I said, depression also seems to have an emotional, social contagious aspect to it as well. So, you know, living with a depressed partner it makes you much more at risk of becoming depressed yourself, not surprisingly, because these attitudes are quite powerful. There's a sort of charisma to depression which can affect your emotionality just being around a depressed person. So if you're a therapist, you have to sort of bear that in mind. Okay. So we all have needs, and this is from human-given psychology. So we all have needs to feel safe and secure, to feel that we're not going to get bombed if we go out the front door, we have needs to feel intimate with other people, we have needs to feel connected to community, we have the need to look after a mind-body system, you know, we have needs to connect to the wider community around us, we have needs for status as well, feeling we have a socially appreciated role, we have a great need for meaning, you know, having a strong sense of meaning in your life means that you can live longer. You know, people live longer if they have a sense of meaning. So we all have these needs, and they're universal, and depressed people kind of depress when they ruminate or introspect about not meeting these needs, okay? And that rumination does something, has an effect on them, okay? So it's worth, and again, as Adam said, you know, if you need these slides, I realize I'm rushing through them because I've got too many slides. Just contact us, and we'll let you have them. Okay, so we have all these needs. Now, I want to talk about dreaming. Okay, this is where we start talking about the cycle of depression. And what has dreaming got to do with depression? What do dreams do? We spend 2 hours a day dreaming. If we're not depressed, we spend 2 hours a day or 2 hours a night dreaming interspersed through the night. Okay. And I'm talking about the work of Joseph Griffin, who many of you would have heard of from human-given psychology, and his understanding written up in The New Scientist about what dreams do. It's the latest sort of understanding of what dreams are for. And he researched thousands of dreams, many of his own, and he found that, first of all, dreams are always expressed in symbology. They're always symbolic. Okay. The symbolism tends to be personal to the person having the dream. So you get these dream dictionaries. If you dream of a banana, then tomorrow you're going to win the lottery and stuff like that, which is kind of very simplistic. But what he found was that people would borrow the symbols and metaphors of the dream from everyday life. Okay. But also he found that dreaming has a very specific function. I'll talk about that in a second. Now, it's been known since the 50s, 1950s, that depressed people dream 2 to 3 times as much as non-depressed people. And a very common feature of depression is waking up exhausted. And something about the overdreaming is exhausting the person. Now, one thing, another symptom of depression is early waking syndrome. Person wakes up very early in the morning and they can't get back to sleep. Okay. It might seem that nature is trying to lift the depression by doing that, because we do a lot of our dreaming in the early hours of the morning. Okay, Something about dreaming or overdreaming is exhausting the depressed person. A very quick way to lift the symptoms of depression is to get someone to stay awake all night, but it's not a treat. So they'll actually have more energy and feel a bit better in the morning, but it's not a treatment for depression, of course, because when they do sleep again, they'll just over-REM, they'll just oversleep again, overdream again. So even if a depressed person is only sleeping 2 hours a night, they'll still be overdreaming during that chunk of sleep, if that makes sense. So you can have insomnia and only sleep here and there, but that's all just dreaming. You're not getting the slow wave sleep. Now, I want to tell you a story about a dream, a client of mine. And she would have this recurring dream. And in this dream, she would be at the helm of a ship, and it would be a stormy sea. It was a stormy sea, but it was always a sunny day. She stressed it was a sunny day in her dream. She'd be on the waves. And her hands would be tied to the steering wheel, if they have steering wheels in ships. And invariably, she'd be attacked by this horrible apparition. A two-headed witch would suddenly materialize and pounce upon her and eventually begin stabbing her. She couldn't defend herself because she was tied to the steering wheel of the ship. And invariably, at that point, she'd wake up in a cold sweat. She said, "What can this mean, Mark? You know, what's that? Am I going crazy? Am I mad? Why do I keep having this dream?" And I asked about her life, and I said, "Well, what do you worry about? You know, what issues are there in your life?" One thing we know about dreaming is that the meaning of the dreaming can be uncovered when you look for a pattern match during the day of the feeling that's exaggerated in the dream. And she talked about her mother-in-law. And she said, "Well," I said, "Well, when did your mother-in-law come to visit?" She said, "Sundays. She always comes on a Sunday, sunny day of the dream, Sunday." Okay. And she said, "Oh God, I just feel like my hands are tied. I can't say anything to her." and she started saying, "She's so two-faced as well." Because, you know, two-headed witch. She's so two-faced because, you know, she's, being nice to me, but then I get it back from my husband that she's been saying this about me and stabbing me in the back and all that. You think, well, there's quite a correlation between that dream and her reality on the Sunday, the sunny day with the two-headed witch stabbing her with her hands are tied. You don't have to be Sigmund Freud or any other lunatic to discern the meaning of that dream. And then... So that's interesting. Now, I had a dream. A dream, it sounds like. Okay. But every... No. I have a dream, and I had a dream that went like this. You know, I've been sitting around watching TV, a program about cancer, and the inevitable sort of statistic, you know, 1 in 4 people will get cancer or whatever it is, you know. And I didn't pay much attention to it. 4 of us in a room, and someone invariably said, "I wonder which one of us it'll be," you know. And I was reading the paper, and I just didn't really register that much. But obviously, it had some kind of emotional kind of trigger. That night, I had a weird dream in which I was walking across a desert, and I became very, very thirsty, and I started feeling like I was going to die of thirst. And suddenly, there was this old lady behind a desk. And in a dream, you don't question it. You know, it's a trance logic, isn't it? And she got 4 cups of water. And she says, "Oh God, you know, I'm dying of thirst here, literally. Can I have a glass of water?" And she said, "Yes, you can, but I have to tell you that one of these 4 glasses is poisoned. Okay, so you kind of—it's a bit of a risk, you know." And I sort of picked up a glass. You can only have 1 glass. So I picked up the glass and started to feel unwell in the dream, and woke up, cold sweat, and thought, "What the hell was that about?" You know, because it's not an obvious match. You don't suddenly straight away link it to the TV program about 1 in 4 people getting cancer. Now what? Joe Griffin found, psychologist, was that we don't dream about stuff that's being expressed or completed. We dream about stuff that hasn't been solved, resolved, or expressed. So if you have a blazing row with your partner and it's resolved and you kiss and make up and everything's all resolved, then you're unlikely to dream about that, okay? Because the limbic system doesn't need to do anything with that. But if you have something that you're really sort of upset about, like, you know, so you can't swear at your boss, but you'd really like to, and you can't say anything about something, then that emotional arousal, in a sense, has started a circuit that needs to be completed. That makes sense. And, you know, to take the energy out of it. But, of course, if you've got the same issues that you're worrying about the next day, then you might have a recurring dream because, you know, nature just uses the same metaphors again and again. So that can occur. Now, we know that during dreaming, serotonin production stops. Okay, so I mentioned earlier that serotonin depletion may be a result of, not a cause of, clinical depression. Okay, and we know that antidepressants inhibit dreaming. Okay, so they can lift some of the symptoms for people. But we also know that placebos can limit dreaming as well, because expectations change, and dreaming is all about emotional expectation. Okay, so, and we also know that hypnotherapeutic procedures can switch off unresolved arousal for people as well, so they don't need to dream about it anymore. So one feature of people coming out of depression is that their dreaming normalizes. Okay, so generally through the night, every 90 to 120 minutes, you dream for about 20 minutes if you're not depressed. If you're depressed, you start dreaming after about 20 minutes, and you dream throughout the night, and you wake up exhausted. And when you explain this to the cycle of depression to people who are depressed, it makes instinctive sense to them. Okay, and they feel kind of understood. So the danger of antidepressants, of course, is that it'll deal with that part of the cycle. Okay, so the person may REM less, they may dream less at night. But if they're still doing the same negative introspection and worrying and churning, non-problem-solving worrying, so it's not switched off, it's not resolved, then they may become a suicide risk, because now they're actually really engaged with negative feelings, but they're motivated, they've got energy released again through not overdreaming to go and kill themselves. So which is probably why antidepressants carry a suicide risk. Okay, when someone starts taking them. Okay, so does that make sense? Or do I sound like a crazy scientist? Good. It's always good to never quite know, do you? Okay. So what we'd need to do is to do something in order to prevent the overdreaming, other than keeping someone awake all night or giving them antidepressants. And so just to recap, so the emotionally arousing introspections, which we know depressed people do, without problem solving them, okay, cause a stress on the REM system at night, meaning less slow wave sleep, meaning exhaustion. So exhausted on two fronts here. Less slow wave sleep, which repairs the immune system. Okay, so we know the immune system of depressed people is impaired, and repairs muscle and so forth, which is why depression can make you physically ill. Okay. But also the rapid eye movement response, okay, that occurs during REM sleep becomes exhausted as well. It's like a flat battery. So so you wake up and the orientation response is exhausted. So nothing's interesting. No, you can't get interested in anything because that's been exhausted during the REMing. Okay. So we know that the REM state occurs outside of sleep as well during shock. Okay, so someone can go into shock. Everything can seem quite dreamlike and hypnotic, and they've gone into REM state. They may have catalepsy, which people also have in the dream state as well, because nature doesn't want us acting out our dreams. If you're dreaming of being Superman or Superwoman and the window's open on a summer's night, you don't want to actually be getting up and diving out of it. Okay, so nature paralyzes us during dream sleep. You get the catalepsy. So someone has so much of that at night, and they can wake up and they literally feel exhausted, okay, because they are exhausted. So that's the cycle of depression, as far as this understanding has it. So any effective treatment for depression will normalize the REM state. Okay, so we got a couple of slides. Okay, too many slides here. And another slightly more complicated slide. if you can explain it to me, please see me afterwards. So, but actually, it's pretty straightforward, okay. And when you approach depression like this, it kind of makes sense. And to my mind, it makes more sense than suddenly thousands, millions more people suddenly having a brain disease, okay, in need of medicalization. If you think about it, the pharmaceutical theory, the medicalization, the disease theory of depression, and it is a theory, is quite depressive. It kind of fits the depressive model, It's global. You are depressed, so everything's depressing. It's about you. It's internal to you. I am a depressive. I have faulty genes. I was born differently. And it's stable, Whenever you come out of depression, you're just waiting to go back into depression, which is your real state, okay? So it's an the explanatory style that we're all using about depression is a depressive explanatory style. And I think we can do better than that. And I think you can do better than that. Okay. Even if you don't buy into anything that I've said today, I still think we can do better than that. Okay. So, you know, as Adam said, it's not just about relaxing a depressed client, although I would say that is essential, because you need to normalize cortisol levels and have them accessing the cognitive parts of the brain again as well. Okay. We need to look at their primal basic needs, their emotional needs. Okay. How can this person start to meet those needs? Okay. There's two ways of switching off an emotional arousal. Either we practically problem solve, okay, or the person feels differently about it. Now, depressed people often think about the past as well. And you think, well, how's thinking about the past an expectation? But as far as your emotional brain is concerned, it is. It's something that hasn't been completed or resolved. Okay. So we know that PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, can trigger depression for some people because it's constantly, you know, it's constantly having to dream and have nightmares about it because the brain is desperately trying to complete the emotional circuit, not able to do so. Okay. How are we doing? Oh, not too bad. And also teaching the depressed person about depression. Okay, do you wake up exhausted? Okay, do you never feel rested? Do you tend to see things in completely this or completely that ways? Talk about the explanatory styles, otherwise known as the attributional styles. See if it makes sense to them. Okay, talk about their basic needs. Do you feel these needs are being met in your life? And so forth. Okay, you know, a primary need is the need to feel safe and secure. And, you know, so someone might objectively be safe and secure, but they don't feel safe and secure, so that need still isn't being met. So we need to help them feel safe and secure, perhaps. Okay. So doing those things will certainly help to get to the right part of the cycle of depression so that the dreaming or the over-REMing kind of normalizes itself so the person can get rest from their sleep again. And the nervous exhaustion dissipates. The person starts feeling energetic, but not in an anxious way, but in a more sort of hopeful way. Okay. I've kind of talked about that. And this is a good thing to remember as well. That even if you help one depressed person, even if you prevent one suicide, then who can say that your life has ever been in vain? Okay. Whatever else you do in life, whatever mistakes you may have made or may make in the future, God knows I've made a few, whatever happens, no one can say that your life has been in vain if you can help one depressed person or prevent one suicide. But I think you can do a lot more than that. Okay. And thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed it.
Great.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Yes.